Everything I do it with a passion. If I gotta be a bitch, I'ma be a bad one. Yeah.
Hey everyone, it's Michelle back here again with another video. Today's video is going to be a review on The Strangers Pray at Night. If you're new to my channel, welcome. I'm Michelle, and for returning subscribers, thanks again, as always, for watching. Now let's get into the review. For anybody who hasn't seen The Strangers or just wants a refresher, the very first movie was a true story. The second one, they're saying, is based on true events as well. First story starts off with a man and a woman. They come from a wedding. They go to spend time at their family cabin, and the guy had asked the girl to marry him, and she had declined. So he wanted to leave. He was waiting for his friend to pick him up when they heard a knock at the door. Is Tamara home? Creepy as all get out. They didn't think much of it. They told her that she had the wrong address, and the girl leaves. The guy ends up taking off to relieve some tension or whatever, goes to get her some smokes to cool off. He was obviously very upset that she said no. And what do you know? There's a knock at the door again. So that's basically how this all starts out, is the girl always comes knocking on the door. Is Tamara home? And then the shit hits the fan. There is one guy and two girls that wear masks, and they just terrorize the hell out of these people all night long. Somehow they're getting into their house, coming in and out, doing all sorts of things, trying to harm them, but not really killing them. They're just scaring them all night long. It is super freaky. I'm not one for ghost stories and things like that, but this is just too realistic and freaks me the hell out. I really enjoyed the first one, so I was really looking forward to it when I saw The Strangers Pray at Night was coming out. I had to go and see it. So The Strangers Pray at Night, again, based on true stories. This time the movie is based around a trailer park home. There's the father, the mother, a son, and a daughter. The daughter had been getting in trouble a lot at school and whatnot, and they wanted to send her to boarding school. So I guess, I don't know if this was their last night as a family, so they went there, or it was on the way to the boarding school. I'm not 100%. So the sister's upset that she's going to a home and crying to her mom and her dad, and ends up taking off outside. They tell the brother to go out after her. So he does. They're out doing whatever, talking, and then the parents hear a knock at the door. Is Tamara home? They tell her, no, you must have the wrong trailer park, motorhome, whatever you want to call it. So she takes off. At this point, the mother is getting a little freaked out. And where are the kids? Why haven't they been back at this point? So they decide to go out after them. This, again, is when all the shit hits the fan. When you're asking for Tamara, you know trouble is coming. The two girls in the masks and the man with the bag over his head, they're out to cause some trouble. They just love terrorizing, and in this movie, killing people. It's very suspenseful. You wouldn't expect it. It really keeps you on the edge of your seat. There is so much action. The one thing I will say is that these actors and actresses, in ways you're just like, oh my god, how can you be so stupid? You're just yelling at the screen like, bitch, shoot that guy! You know, you just get right into it, and you just want to see these bad guys die, and they keep almost killing them and then just letting them away so they can continue terrorizing them. And it's so frustrating, but also so good, and just keeps you like tense, you know? You feel anxiety the whole damn time, but it's good in a way. There are some really shocking things that the family does to protect themselves and their family against these horrible, horrible people. And you're just like, yes, everybody in the theater was so into it. And yes, girl, you know, you grow to love the family. You just want to see them come out alive. You just want to see them beat these people. I loved it, honestly. It really gets you on the edge of your seat. Something bad happens right in the beginning that just throws you off your path, and you're just like, what the hell? You don't know what's gonna happen. In the end, there's a pretty happy ending, but you know what? At the end, it leaves you feeling like there may be a Strangers 3. I don't know exactly what the story is behind these people with the masks, but they're both based on true stories. So I guess these few people, three or four people, have gone around terrorizing and killing numerous groups of people or families, and I don't know if they really ever got caught. It doesn't really explain that. And if they're making it like there's going to be a third one, how many people have they done this to, and have they been caught? How long ago was this? They don't really give you a storyline behind that. I'm actually going to look into it, and any information I find, I'm going to put up here in this video for anybody else that might just be interested in the backstory.
So there are a lot of theories behind the true story behind the strangers, but the director, Brian Bertino, has confirmed that he combined his haunting childhood experience with the tragic Manson murders and set a plot that revolves around the idea of, what if you were in your house and a group of people decided to break in? This is a scenario that many can relate, since it could happen to anyone at any time. The phrase, because you were home, became the slogan for some of the posters for the movie and appears in the film when the unlucky couple ask the tormentors why. So sure, maybe the Manson murders aren't a direct true story of the strangers, but with this being one of the more famous home invasions in history, and Bertino confirming his inspiration through the story, we consider this to be some mighty, scary, real-world horror. That's spooky enough, especially as a little kid, but further inspiration came later. You probably are more familiar with this one. The idea that helped spark the strangers came from when Bertino read the true crime books, Helter Skelter, where two of the most appalling Manson family murders occurred. Upon looking at this stuff, it is pretty obvious that one of those two cases has similarities with the strangers' plot. Manson family was a hippie commune led by Charles Manson, a manipulative mastermind that had the power to guide the members of the commune into committing a series of murders, spreading panic and terror. Leno and Rosemary were a successful business couple. They lived in LA. On August 10th, 1969, they returned to their home from Lake Isabel, where they spent most of their weekend. What happened later that day was a nightmare coming true, especially for Rosemary, who was already worried and alarmed by the multiple murders that happened the previous night in the neighborhood, and she was rightfully worried. Charles Manson himself, along with Tex Watson, broke into the house and found Leno sleeping in the living room and his wife in the bedroom. After they brought Rosemary into the living room, they tied up their arms and legs and put pillowcases over their head and proceeded to steal whatever they could. Manson then went back to the car and told two members of his family, Patricia and Leslie, to go into the house and follow the directions from Tex. The girls went in and took Rosemary into the bedroom. Tex started stabbing Leno in the living room, who started screaming bloody murder. Immediately after Leno's first scream, his wife started yelling and resisting with all of her powers. The Manson girls, unable to control Rosemary, asked for Tex's help. Tex ran in to the bedroom, and without hesitation, he started stabbing Miss LaBianca, then gave the knife to the girls and told them to continue stabbing the victim. He then went back to the living room and continued his horrific crime by finishing up Leno and carving on his stomach the word war, a reference to the apocalyptic race war that the Manson family believed will soon initiate. They also wrote on the walls using the victim's blood, death to pigs and rise, plus a misspelled Helter Skelter on the fridge. The Beatles song Helter Skelter was, according to Manson, a description of this future race war that he believed would inevitably happen. Rosemary was stabbed a total of 41 times and her husband a total of 26 times with a knife that was left in his throat and a fork in his stomach. Rosemary's son Frank found his parents' brutally slaughtered bodies the next day. So to sum it all up, the movies were loosely based upon a true event for Bertino's own childhood, as well as the infamous string of real-life murders that shocked America. Bertino explained, around the time of the Strangers' release, "As a kid, I lived in a house on a street in the middle of nowhere. One night while our parents were out, somebody knocked on the front door and my little sister answered it. At the door were some people who were asking for somebody who didn't live there. We later found out that these people were knocking on doors in the area, and if no one was home, they were breaking into houses."
But there's one lesser known case that inspired the strangers, and it's far more terrifying than Bertino's film, known as the Keddie Cabin Murders. This horrific quadruple homicide took place in California in 1981 and remains unsolved to this day. Unsolved murders are fairly common, but the sheer brutality of the case makes this one particularly unsettling. The murders took place on the evening of April 11th or the early morning of April 12th, 1981, in Keddie, a small defunct railroad town in Plumas County, California. Sue Sharp and her five kids had rented cabin 28 at the Keddie Resort, where they had stayed since the previous November after Sue left her abusive husband. On the evening of the murders, Sue was home with her two youngest boys, Greg and Rick, who had their friend Justin over for the evening. Sue's oldest boy, Johnny, came home later in the evening with his friend, Dana. The eldest daughter, Sheila, was spending the night at her friend's nearby, while the youngest daughter, Tina, came home.
From watching TV with a neighboring friend sometime that evening, in the early morning hours of April 12th, Sheila returned home from her friend's cabin to retrieve some clothes so she could attend church with her friend's family. That's when she discovered the brutally murdered bodies of her mother, Johnny, and Dana. 22 feet of white cloth medical tape, which did not come from Sue's cabin, was used to bind the limbs of the bodies along with the extension cord from the television. Dull, flimsy table knife was found near Johnny's body, and a bloody hammer and butcher knife was found on the table, though the autopsy showed that the two bodies had been bludgeoned by two different hammers. Johnny and Dana were found with multiple stab wounds on their body and their throats. Dana had been strangled while Johnny had been bludgeoned by a rifle that was never found. A trash can at a nearby general store yielded another bloody knife. While Sheila, Rick, and Greg all survived, Tina was still missing. Judging by the police reports, some believe that Tina's absence was not immediately recorded, nor was it given much consideration. In 1984, a human skull fragment was found about 29 miles from the Keddie Resort, but it still took months before the police searched the area. And they only did so after receiving an anonymous call that the skull fragments belonged to Sue's missing daughter. A search of the area turned up several more bone fragments, and testing confirmed that the bones belonged to Tina. Adding further eeriness to the case is Justin, Rick, and Greg's friend, who was sleeping over at the time of the murders. In a statement given to police, Justin described a scene that reads as half dream, half reality, in which two men attack Sue on a boat that resembles the cabin's living room. Johnny and Dana arriving home in the middle of the crime, the two older boys confront the assailants and are ultimately subdued and restrained. Tina was awoken by the noise and walked in on the killers. As she was dragged away, Justin maintains that this was not a dream, but that he did witness the murders, or at least some portion of the events. Given his younger age, 12, and the traumatic circumstances, it's easy to see how the details of the crime may have blended with the dream Justin was having as he woke. Obviously some similarities between the Keddie Cabin murders and the Strangers. Liv Tyler and Scott Speedman's characters are mercilessly stalked in their summer home. And while Keddie was a defunct railroad town filled with disenfranchised residents, the idea of a cabin calls to mind a relaxing vacation. Bertino's film climaxes with the protagonist bound to chairs in the living room and brutally stabbed. These crimes, both in Bertino's fiction and Keddie's reality, were committed in the victims' homes, making them even more disquieting. It's horrifically invasive, turning someone's comfort into an intangible weapon. Ultimately, the Strangers remain so effectively scary because Bertino is faithful to the terror of the unknown. And while horror films have long served as catharsis for innate fear of death, Bertino's film yields only sheer dread. The dread that grows with the understanding of just how close to reality this movie is. Here's a sketch drawn up of the murderers because they are still at large.
If you're into true story scary movies, if you're into stuff that's very realistic that could very well happen, I would definitely check it out. There are some funny parts as well. The way that like the father reacts when he gets hurt is comical, okay? I'm not one to laugh at people getting hurt, but the way he was carrying on screaming and almost screaming and laughing at the same time, it was just like, you couldn't help but laugh. It was really enjoyable. There's action, there's killing, there's some funny parts, there's some heartfelt parts. Overall, a really good movie. So thanks so much for watching my review. Please do give it a thumbs up if you enjoy these kind of videos. And if you want to see more videos of me, subscribe, please and thank you. And until the next time, bye!